ஓம் மைந்து கரத்தனை ஆனை முகத்தனை இந்தின் இளம்பிறை போன்றைய ஈற்றினை நந்தி மகந்தனை ஞானக் கொழுந்தினை புந்தியில் வைத்தடி போற்றுகின்றேனே.
வசுதேவ சுதம் தேவம் கம்சச்சானுரமர்தனம் தேவகீ பரமானந்தம் கிருஷ்ணம் வந்தே ஜகத்குரும் கிருஷ்ணம் வந்தே ஜகத்குரும் கிருஷ்ணம் வந்தே ஜகத்குரும்.
ஓகே, வேர் ஆன் தி 50th ஸ்லோக. புத்தி யுக்தா இஹ உபே சுகிருத்தோ துஷ்கிருத்தோ ஜஹாதி தஸ்மாத் யோகாய யுஜஸ்வ யோகா கர்மசு கௌசலம். திஸ் ஸ்லோகா வி ஸ்டார்டட். புத்தி யுக்தா, வாட் இஸ் மீன் புத்தி யுக்தா? யூஸ் யுவர் வாட் கால் புத்தி. யூஸ் த புத்தி இஸ் செட் டு பி கெப்ட், ஷுட் பி கெப்ட் வெரி ஷார்ப். யூனோ, வென் த புத்தி இஸ் சாத்விக் இஸ் வெரி ஷார்ப். வென் புத்தி இஸ் நாட் சாத்விக் இட் இஸ் பிளண்டட். ஒன்ஸ் வித் பிளண்டட் புத்தி இட் இஸ் வெரி டிஃபிகல்ட் டு அண்டர்ஸ்டாண்ட் எ லாட் ஆஃப் தீஸ் திங்ஸ். ஓகே, ஸோ புத்தி யுக்தா, கீப்பிங் யுவர் மைண்ட் ஷார்ப். ஓகே, இஹ மீன்ஸ் இன் திஸ் லைஃப், இஹ இன் திஸ் லைஃப். உபே சுக்ருத்து துஷ்கிருத்தவ், உபே மீன்ஸ் போத். வாட் ஆர் த போத் திங்ஸ்? சுக்ருத்து துஷ்கிருத்து. யூ டூ குட் ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ், யூ கெட் யூனோ ஹாப்பி ரிசல்ட்ஸ். தட்ஸ் வாட் யூ செட் இன் தி யோக சூத்ரஸ் ஆல்சோ. தத்விபாகோ ஜாதி ஆயிர்போ தே ஹ்லாத பரிதாபலாக புண்ணிய அப்புண்ணிய ஹேத்துவாத். ஹ்லாதபல பரிதாபல, ஹ்லாத மீன்ஸ் ஹாப்பி. ஹாப்பி ரிசல்ட்ஸ் கம் வென் யூ டூ குட் ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ், புண்ணிய ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ். ஹ்லாத பரிதாபல, தி ரிசல்ட்ஸ் ஆர் அன்ஹாப்பி இஃப் தி ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ் ஆர் பாப. பாப மீன்ஸ் சின்ஃபுல் ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ். ஹ்லாத பரிதாப பலாக புண்ணிய அப்புண்ணிய ஹேத்துவாது. ஓகே, ஸோ தி சேம் ஐடியா ஹியர். சுக்ருத்து துஷ்கிருத்தோ, சுக்ருத்து மீன்ஸ் குட் ரிசல்ட்ஸ், துஷ்கிருத்து மீன்ஸ் பேட் ரிசல்ட்ஸ். சுக்ருத் துஷ்கிருத்தவ் உபே ஜஹாதி ஹி கிவ்ஸ் அப் கிவ்ஸ் அப் போத் தி குட் ரிசல்ட்ஸ். தட் இஸ் யூ கான்ட் சே தட் ஓகே ஐ வில் டேக் வாட் இஸ் குட் அண்ட் நோ நாட் டேக் வாட் இஸ் பேட். நோ, இட் டசன்ட் ஒர்க் அவுட் தட் வே. ஒன்ஸ் யூ கெட் அட்டாச் டு யுவர் ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ் அண்ட் த ரிசல்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் திஸ், இஃப் த ரிசல்ட்ஸ் ஆர் குட் யூ வில் கோயிங் டு கெட் இட். இஃப் யுவர் ஆக்டிவிட்டீஸ் ஆர் பேட் இட் இஸ் கோயிங் டு ப்ரொடியூஸ் பேட் ரிசல்ட்ஸ் தட் வித் விச் யூ ஆர் கோயிங் டு பி பவுண்ட். யூ ஆர் கோயிங் டு ரிசீவ் தோஸ் ரிசல்ட்ஸ். But whereas this yogi gives up right in the beginning, he says, no, this is not for me. I am not interested in the results. I am doing it as a duty. I am doing this as my duty. This is the attitude of the yogi. This is the attitude of the yogi. So in the next, statement, he says, Tasmat yogaya yujasva. Tasmat, therefore, yogaya. Yogaya means in the path of yoga. What is the path of yoga? Doing all the activities without, renouncing the results thereof. In the sense, mentally you say that I'm not doing it for the sake of the results, right? And then he says, yogaha karmasu kaushalam. What is it? Karmasu? Karmasu means in or among. Both the meaning can be given to that word, in or among. Here, most of the people translate as karmasu in activities. Karmasu means in activities. Kaushala means efficiency. Efficiency or skill in action is yoga. There is one interpretation. We take the word karmasu as among activities, karmasu as among activities, yoga karmasu kaushalam. Among all activities, yoga is karmasu. The word kaushala means, kushala means a sharp thing, very sharp. You know, something with, there is a grass in India, you know, they call it the kushala grass. When you dry that, it's so sharp, it's like some paper, some paper, if you are careless, you can cut your skin, So likewise, the brain is articulated, buddhi is very sharp. Yoga karmasu kaushalam. It is the yoga. Yoga is the sharpest or the best or the most superior among all activities. What do you mean by that? What he says, if you do activities as a yogi, what is it by doing activities as a yogi? I am not going to be concerned about the results thereof. I am going to focus my attention on the activity. Absolutely, I am going to focus my attention only on the activities, without bothering about the results. If that is the case, then it's called karma yoga, or whatever you want to call it, karma. So yoga karmasu kaushalam. Whereas all other people, when they start doing any particular activity, their mind is mostly on the results thereof. And then exactly this is what the yoga sutras also say. Karma ashukla akrishnam yoginaha. Yoginaha karma, the activities of yogis, ashukla akrishnam. Shukla means white, krishna means black. Shukra, white means sattvic karma or punya karma. Then the next one, Ashukla, Akrishna. Krishna means black, which means bad karmas, you know. It's neither good or bad. Ashukla, Akrishna, yogi's activities. Yoginaha karma, Ashukla, Krishna. Because it is neither punya karma or not papa karma, it will not lead to an accumulation of karma, so that you will be required to reap the consequences of our activities in the future, either in this janma or in the future. So far as other people are concerned, it is Trivida. What is meant by Trivida? It can be either Shukla, that means, you know, punya karmas, meritorious activities, or Krishna karma, which can be not meritorious, or Mishra karma. Sometimes when you do, it is good and also bad. In some aspects it is good, in some aspects it is bad. So all the human activities are said to be Mishra. Mishra means it is mixed. Okay. Let's go to the 51st sloka.
Karmajam buddhi yuktahi phalam tyaktvamanishinaha janma bandha vinirmuktaha padam gacchanti anamayam.
Buddhi yuktaha, you see the second term, buddhi yuktaha. What is yukta? Yukta means united with. Buddhi yuktaha, when a person whose whole, what do you call, emotions are completely united with buddhi, that is, he uses his buddhi. Buddhi yuktaha. Manishinaha. Manishinaha means those people who are wise people. Manishinaha. Karmajam phalam. Karmajam phalam. Karma means activity. Jam means arising out of karma. Karmajam phalam. The results arising out of activities. Karmajam phalam tyaktva. They give it up. I mean, he's repeating it over and over again, you know. Janma bandha vinirmuktaha. So there is no accumulation of activities. There is no accumulation of the karma phala. So it will not lead them to next janma, okay?
Janma bandha vinirmuktaha anamaya, the painless padam hi gacchanti.
Then what happens when they don't accumulate any janma, what happens over a period of time, their mind becomes absolutely peaceful and they reach the ultimate stage of yoga, which is kaivalya or which is moksha, which are nirvana, brahma nirvana, like that different terms are used. And what is the, he says anamaya. Anamaya means painless, you know, at that stage their mind experiences no pain at all, but it is able to know the true nature of the self. This becomes possible only when the mind is able to completely become, you know, restful. It is able to rest. How can it rest? Once it is able to give up all the what you call hankering after the results of various activities, you know, you go about doing your activities, over a period of time there is no further accumulation, and then mind becomes absolutely peaceful. Already, even activities are of three kinds. Nitya karma, naimitya karma, and kamya karma. Karma means activities. It is of three types. What does it mean, nitya karma? Those things that you are required to do on a daily basis. I have to have a shower, I got to brush my teeth, you know. A lot of daily activities I got to do. So it's called nitya karma. I mean, in the olden days, they gave a list of things that you are required to do. Ishwara puja, I was one of them, you know. Meditating on the Lord, like that, they gave a list of things that you are required to do. If you do it, you don't get anything out of that. You know, you don't accumulate any karma. If you don't do it, you incur demerit, you incur papa. You are required to do that. You know, you can't avoid that. This is called nitya karma. There are like a naimitya karma. There are certain occasions where you are required to do certain things. For instance, if I get married, on the day I'm getting married, I got to do a lot of rituals. I'm required to do a lot of rituals. Naimitya, you know, at different occasions. In fact, during our lifetime, we are supposed to go through 40 different stages, and in each one of them, there are certain things that are supposed to be done. This is called naimitya karma. Then kamya karma. Kamya karma are those things that you do so that you want something. In the olden days, because science had not developed as it developed, so the only way you can get something extraordinary was to pray to the various gods. Various gods. You pray to, if there is no rain, you pray to Varuna, the god of rain. If you need children, in that case, then what you do? You do a yajna called putra kameshti yaga. Like that, there were a number of rituals were there. They are called kamya karma. You need something, and for that, you are doing it. Nowadays, we don't do it, but still we are able to get our things done. Supposing I want to have a house, what do? I got to work hard, get money, and then build a house. This kamya karma. Okay.
Can you go to the next one? Yada te moha kalilam buddhir vyatitarishyati tadagantasi nirvedam shrotavyasya shrutasya cha.
Yada means whenever. Yada te means your buddhi, intellect. When your intellect, moha kalilam, is confused, the way Arjuna is at that particular moment, vyathitarishyati. When you are able to overcome this confusion, you know, you are now under a lot of confusion. I have started helping you to clear that confusion. I'm sure you will be able to overcome the confusion in the near future. Tada then, shrotavyasya shrutasya cha nirveda gantavya. Shrotavyasya, shrotavya means whatever has been heard through the Vedas. The Vedas say that you do this particular karma, you can go to this heaven. I think I mentioned to you earlier. Like that, there are a number of things which are mentioned in the karma portion of the Vedas. And then shrutasya cha. And then in future also, you will hear about a lot of things. You can do this so that you can become a greater king. You can do this, you can go to heaven. Like that, there are going to be a number of things that will be told to you. Shrotavya shrutasya cha nirveda gantasya cha. You develop disinterested in all these things. Nirveda is disinterest. What he says is, not only now, even in the future, don't allow your mind to be attracted by all the kamya karmas. Don't allow your mind to be distracted by the various allurements that you will be able to see in life. Not only in this life, but also all promises going to heaven and this and that. Gantasi, nirveda. Nirveda means develop total disinterest in that. Gantasi, you reach that stage. Now, as it is, he's talking about what will happen to my grandfather, what will happen to my teacher, what will happen to my friends, what will happen. Lots of things he's now worried about, you know. Now he says that, you know, none of these things you should be worrying about, okay. Once you are able to keep your mind sharp, and then don't get interested in the in whatever that is mentioned in the Vedas or whatever you hear from other people, that's another thing. You got somebody says, all right, oh no, I went to a seminar, yoga seminar. Such and such is such teacher says this, okay, now I go there. Then next week later, a Swamiji from India comes. You go there, spend a day, and then he gives you a mantra. You take that mantra, chant it for 2 days, third day you forget it. All these things are further distractions. They are all further distractions. You take a little time, go around, see, audit in a few places, and after some time you must make up your mind to stay with one system. Forget about one teacher, at least. Try to stay with one system so that it'll be helpful. Otherwise, the entire lifetime will be spent in trying to find out what is right and what is wrong, and ultimately I am going to be confused. This is what he says. Number of things will be told later on. You know, when you become the king, you know, they are going to say, you do this particular yajna, you do this particular, all those things will be. Now you are not going to be interested in this. Focus your attention on Atma. Do whatever you are required to do. Take care of yourself.
Shruti vipratipannate tadastasyati nishchala samadha vachala buddhihi tada yogam avapsyasi.
Okay, yada whenever shruti pratipanna, confused by the karma portion of the vadis or other worldly pursuits, okay, both of them are there. Shruti pratipanna, you know, shruti pratipanna. We read the Vedas, they say, okay, you do this particular yajna. They have done a number of yajnas. These Pandavas have done a number of yajnas. Rajasuya yajna, they did a number of yajnas. They have done that. They are, as kings, they are required to do a lot of things. They have done that. But now here, what you call, Krishna advises him, don't get involved into all these things. Do whatever you do. What should you do? Run the current country, you know, in a just manner. That's about all what you have got to do. Shruti pratipanna or other allurements, if you find in the world, te your buddhi, you know, buddhi samadhav nishchala achala stasyasi tada yogam avapyasi. Once you are not disturbed by the outside influences, like the Vedas tell you something so that you can go to heaven after death. But I don't want another birth at all. That's my whole goal. So if I do all the things that are mentioned in the Vedas, I will go to heaven, but I am not interested in that. Okay, that is one. The other thing is, in the worldly activities, you can do a lot of things so that you can improve your lot. Even that I am not interested. My only interest is to understand my own self. My mind should remain in the knowledge of the true self. Okay, so in this case, what he says is, once you start preventing yourself being distracted by all these influences, after some time, already I have been doing this for a couple of years, 2 or 3 years, you must be able to think and then settle down, you know. Settle down. No. This is what I am going to do. This is what I should be doing. Buddhi, samadhav nishchala, samadhav. Samadhav means what? In yoga, in samadhi, you are able to get into samadhi. Then nishchala, mind becomes undisturbed. It is able to remain focused, nishchala. Achala, and then it is firm, achala. Okay, stasyasi, it remains, tada yogam avapyasi. Then I can say that you have achieved yoga. Then 54, Arjuna vacha, Arjuna said,
Stita prajnasya ka bhasha samadhistasya keshava stitadi kim prabhasheta kim asita vrajeta kim.
Now he says, your mind should be firm. Mind should be firm in the nature of the self. Don't get distracted from the way influences the outside world. You know, that is what the ultimate. Then what happens? Your mind will be established in the samadhi. Mind will be established in mamadhi. And then your prajna, your intellect will be firm. You know, you won't be disturbed by lots of the influence from the outside world. Arjuna wants to know, all right, I am not able to see this. I don't see anybody with that kind of samadhi capability. I don't have anybody like that. Now he asks him a question, how can I identify that? What will be the other, manifestations, symptoms? All of them look alike, you know, I should be able to know what is the difference between a person, you know, who is absolutely in a state of samadhi. So in this shloka, he asks this question, Arjuna vacha Keshava. What is meant by Keshava? Thank you. Keshava, samadhistasya. Samadhistasya. Stha means to stay. Samadhistaha, one who is established in samadhi. Tasya, his. Samadhistasya. The one who is in samadhi, his. Sthita prajnasya. He is also called sthita prajna. Sthita means steady. Prajna means awareness. His mind is steady. He is also, samadhi staha, he is also in a state of samadhi, his mind is steady. Bhasha, vasa, what are the, bhasha means what are the indications of such a person. Ka sthitadihi, what is meant by firm intellect? You have talked about a firm intellect, what is meant by firm intellect that you are talking about? Kim vat prabhashate, what will he talk about? What will he be talking about, you know, will he talk about the next movie or what, you know, what will he be talking about? Prabhashati. Kim asita, how does he sit? Kim vrajeta, how does he conduct himself? Okay, this is the next question. How can a distinguished yogi and a one who is not a yogi? Sri Bhagavan vacha, for this question, the Lord answers,
Prajahati yada kaman sarvan parthamano gatan atman yevatmana tushtaha stuta prajnaha tadochyate.
Partha, what is it by Partha?
Arjuna.
Partha means Arjuna, right, thank you. Partha, yada when manogatana, mana means mind, gatana means arising, manogatana or moving, when the mind moves, you know, different thoughts arise in the mind. Manogatana, sarvana, kamana, even all our desires rise in your mind, all the desires come in your mind. Manogatana, kaman, prajahati. See, now he says this will have to be tackled at the level of the mind itself, you know. Whenever the thoughts, desires come in the mind, I should be able to tackle that at that stage itself. Yada manogatan sarvan kaman prajahati, one who gives up all the desires at the budding stage itself, atmani eva atmana tushta. Whereas on the other hand, the mind atmani eva, in its own real self. You know, this becomes very important here. It becomes, the nature of the self becomes very important. Atmani eva atmana tushtaha. You know, my atmana here refers to the mind. Atmani means the real atman. My mind should be satisfied with the nature of my own self. Not should be, it will be. It will be satisfied with the nature of this. I think yesterday we talked about it. Some people talk about it. Some people hear about it. Some people are able to see this. All of them are in the state of wonder. Atmana, atmani, tushtaha. Now, after knowing the atman, this yogi, he is now talking about the yogi in sthira prajna. Such a yogi, tushtaha, he is absolutely satisfied. Tushta means satisfied. There is nothing else he wants. He doesn't want anything else. Atmana, atmani, tushtaha. Tada, sthita prajnaha. Then he is called a sthita prajna, because the mind is not going to waver anywhere, because the mind is always with the atman and it is absolutely satisfied with the atman. Supposing to a certain person, you come and ask him, why don't you come, there is going to be a Gita seminar in Mount Abu or on the Everest, you know, we got a camp, many people are coming there. He said, no, thank you, there is no interest, I am happy looking at the nature of my own self. And such a person is called Sthita Prajna, because you cannot distract him at all. That is why in the olden day they talk about yogi is going to samadhi. Once they go into samadhi, it is not easy for you to disturb them. You can't even, they won't hear you. Even if you shake them, you know, they won't feel the touch. So that kind of ekagrata, that kind of an ekagrata is there in a state of samadhi. Oh, such a person is called Sthita Prajna. Sthita means firm. Prajna means awareness. 56.
Dukkeshu anudvigramanaha, sukeshu vigataspruhaha, vitaraga bhayakrodaha, sthitadihi munihi ucchate.
Now he was asking about sthitadihi, one who has got a firm intellect, firm mind, you know, sthitadihi. So he is explaining that question.
Dukkeshu anudvigramanaha,
dukkeshu, dukkha, what is dukkha? Come on, say something. What is dukkha? Dukkha means pain. Okay, dukkeshu, in dukkha, okay. Anudvigramanaha means somebody who is with an unchanging mind. Okay, I am feeling bad, what do you call it? There is something dukkha, my mind is not going to change. Even though I am a lot of pain, I am not going to change. I mean, he will be able to put up with that because he is already known the true nature of the self. Likewise, sukheshu vigataspruhaha. Sukeshu, sukha takes place, happy things happen, anuvigramanaha, he doesn't get attached to the object that gave him happiness. Anuvigramanaha, sukeshu vigataspruhaha. Vigataspruhaha means doesn't get attached to that. Spruha means contact, you know. He doesn't get involved with the object that gave him happiness. Vita raga bhayakrodaha. Vita means given up, you know, in him. Vita raga. Raga means what? Yeah, raga means desire, attachment. The word raga means ranjayiti the raga, like a glue, you know. Sometimes something gives me happiness, my mind thinks about it all the time. I can't be without it. I'm glued to it. Raga, raga. Vita means given up. I have no raga. Vita, raga, bhaya, krodha. Krodha means what? Anger. Krodha means anger. I have neither, what you call, attachment nor enmity towards anything. Okay, these are two sides of the same thing. I like something, if I get that, I'm happy. If I, for some reason, I'm not able to get that, I'm going to be angry. So these are two sides of the same coin, the same rajasic tendency. And then he also includes the third one, bhaya. What is bhaya? Bhaya is fear. Fear is due to what? Fear is due to tamas. Fear is tamas because you don't really think through the whole thing, there is fear. When you don't prepare yourself and want to go to a class, what happens? There is fear, isn't it? What am I going to do? So if you prepare yourself, you know what you want to do, then you know that fear is not there. Vita raga bhaya krodaha. Vita given up. Raga means desire. Krodha means enmity. Both of them are not there. These are rajasic tendency. In addition to there is a tamasic tendency, which is bhaya, fear. So vita raga bhaya krodaha. All the three he puts. Raga and dvesha forming part of the rajas. Bhaya is due to tamas. So without rajas and tamas, that's the meaning of this. Vita raga bhayakrodaha. Munihi sthitadihi ucchate. Muni is another term for a sage. Munihi sthitadihi. Sthita means firm. Dihi means intellect. Sthitadihi, firm intellect, ucchate. He is known as a sthitadhi, or a one with a firm intellect. Okay, we'll go to the next one.
Ya sarvatran abhisnehaha tattat prapya shubha shubham nabhinandanti nadveshti tasya prajna pratishtita.
The person's mind is said to be well established. Now the next sutra in similar lines, the same lines, he says, yaha means whosoever, sarvatra means everywhere, sarvatra anabhisneha, doesn't get attached to anything. If a person, wherever he goes, wherever he is, he doesn't get attached to anything. I don't say I like Los Angeles. I don't say I dislike Chicago. I don't say that. I have no preference. I have absolutely no preference. That is why in the olden days, the sannyasis will not stay in a place for more than 3 days because they get attached to that particular place. You start developing friends, you form a sangha, you know, they don't want that. So they are required to keep on moving. So sarvatra, everywhere, anabhisnehaha, don't get attached to any place. Tatu, whatever. Shubha ashubha, good happenings, bad happenings. Whether you are a yogi or a non-yogi, it's going to happen. That's the nature of prakriti. Sometimes good things happen, sometimes bad things happen. they keep on happening. That's the nature of Prakriti. Everybody is affected. There's nobody who is not affected by good things. There's nobody who is not affected by bad things. Shubha Shubho Prapya, having obtained, you know, having what you call, got into such situations, Abhinandati. Abhinandati means he doesn't celebrate. Okay, he doesn't celebrate. Supposing I get $1 million, you know, I don't celebrate. I will, but then. Na abhinandati, na dveshti. At the same time, something happens, something bad happens, na dveshti. I don't hate the cause for my misfortune. I don't hate that. Abhinandati, na dveshti. Tasya prajna pratishtita. If my mind is like this, such a mind is well established. Good.
Yada samharate chayam kurmongani sarvashah indriyani indriyartebhyah tasya prajna pratishtita.
Now, all these advice are given to, given to Arjuna, who is an ordinary being like all of us, you know. He is in a difficult life situation, you know. It's difficult, you know. Fighting with your neighbor is okay, but if the neighbor happens to be your relative, it's difficult. Am I right? Yes. So that's a problem he is having, you know. We come across these problems. We sometimes fight with our relatives, sometimes husband and wife fight, sometimes partners fight, you know. These are all situations which test the individual character, you know. Here he says that you do whatever you are required to do, and then from now onwards don't get further entangled into worldly activities. Don't get further entangled, because Arjuna has had a past of allowing his senses to go astray. He, you know, if you look at the Mahabharata, you know, he was not a saint, you know. So he says at this particular point, all right, enough is enough. Do this whatever you are required to do. Now I will give you whatever you should do for the rest of your life. I will give you the instructions right now. Because once the war is over, you will go back and start doing whatever you want to do. This is the best opportunity for me to tell you what you should do. So the best opportunity for Krishna to advise Arjuna was this time, you know. So that is why in a time of crisis, that is the best time to receive proper advice.
Yada samharate chayam kurma angani vasarvashah indriyani indriyartyebhyah tasya prajna pratishtita.
Then he gives an example, you know, how should you do? He says, he keeps on saying, the most common reason for our difficulties is allowing the indriyas to have their own free reign. Yeah. They are allowed to do whatever they want to do. You follow your senses. You keep on allowing your senses to guide you. So he gives the example of a turtle, kurmaha. Kurmaha. Kurma means, you know, kurmasana. You have an idea about what. You stretch your arms and then try to bring your hands behind your back. The legs are also close to the body. Yeah. Kurmaha angani eva. Angani means its limbs, you know, the limbs. Angani eva, like the kurma contracts its limbs. Yada then I am this yogi. Indriyartebhyah.
What is by indriya?
Indriya means the senses. My ears, my nose, my skin, my tongue. These are the indriyas. Okay. Indriyartha. The objects of them, I like to see good things. I feel happiness through my eyes by looking at good things. I hear good things, you know, so that I'll be able to get some more happiness through my ears. So indriyas give me pleasure. Indriyas give me pleasure. The outside world per se does not give me any pleasure. Only the indriyas, you know, get those things sent to my mind. The mind is able to feel some happiness out of this.
Indriyartebhyah indriyani sarvashah samharate.
So what he says is, just like a turtle is able to draw all the limbs and hold it within itself, you also try to draw all your senses inward and then keep it with your own mind. Because mind is the one that coordinates. One of the methods by which the yogis are able to, both symbolically and, you know, effectively, is using a method known as Shanmukhi Mudra. You know Shanmukhi Mudra? You close your ears, you close your eyes, partially close the nostrils, keep your mouth shut, and then stay there for a few minutes. So that during the period of 5 minutes or 10 minutes or 15 minutes, you are in Shanmukhi Mudra. You don't allow the eyes to open and then see all the objects. You don't hear anything from the outside world. Then, of course, during that time, you don't eat anything. Like that, you try to symbolically, you say, no, I don't want my senses to distract me. I have done a lot of activities. I have done asanas. I have done pranayama. I have done yamaniyamas, so that I am able to slowly get away from the outside world for a short period of time. During the yoga period, I don't want any contact with the outside world. That's a quality time with myself. Yoga time is a quality time with yourself. I want to spend the entire time with myself. I don't want any distraction. Unfortunately, these are the ports. These are the senses, are the openings through which my mind is going outside. So I want to block them, at least for the short period of time. So you stop the sensations reaching your senses. So that is what he says. Indriyani sarvashaha samharate tasya prajna pratishtita. If I am able to completely become oblivious to the various sensations that are produced by objects, if I am able to stay clear of all the objects of the outside world, like a turtle is able to draw all the limbs and then stay. When it sees any danger, what does it do? Immediately it is able to draw the limbs and then, you know, waits until the danger goes away. Isn't it? Yeah, it is what it is supposed to do. Likewise, at least for an hour every day, I must try to say, okay, this is my yoga time. I don't want any distraction because I am spending my time. It's an Atma Vidya. I want to go spend the time with myself. I want to spend the entire 1 hour with my own self, with my body, with my mind, with my breath. That's what I'm going to do now. So at that time, I don't want to be distracted. You stay ekagra, you stay alone in a room and then practice your yoga. You practice your yoga. Try to completely stop distractions for that particular time. When the yogi is able to do it on a continuous basis, then his mind is said to be well established. We'll go to the next one, 59.
Vishaya vinivartante nirahārasya dehinaha rasavarjam rasopyasya param drushtva nivartate nirahārasya dehinaha. A person who prevents the senses from going out, nirahara. Ahara means what? Object. Ahara means food, Nirahara means food. Ahara means food. We eat food through our mouth and we also get a lot of food from the outside world. I hear a lot of things. It's my ahara. I am taking a lot of things from the outside world. If somebody says some information is given to you, that is ahara for the ears. And then you see something and then that is ahara for the eyes. Ahara, ahara means food. In fact, there's a beautiful shloka in the Chandogya Upanishad. Ahara shuddhau sattva shuddhihi. Ahara shuddhau. When the food that you take is shuddhi or sattvic, sattva shuddhihi, the mind also becomes shuddhi. Because the mind is nothing but the food that you take. That is converted into your brain. So when you are taking food which is sattvic, your mind also will become sattvic. Now the word ahara, Shankaracharya interprets in a wider sense. Ahara shuddhau sattva shuddhi, he says, it doesn't mean only the food that you take, it also means what you hear. Supposing you go to a place where, lot of junk is spoken around, then that is not good ahara, it is going to spoil your mind. Ahara shuddhau sattva shuddhi. So here what you try to do, you try to completely, starve the senses or give rest to the senses so that they are not distracted by their aharas. Niraharasya, when the objects are prevented from the senses, dehinaha, the yogi, vishaya, the objects, vinivartante, they slowly withdraw. Right now, it is automatic. The moment an object is given to me, immediately my senses go to that particular object. Like an animal, if you give some food to the dog, immediately it comes and takes the food. Here, you start your discretion, okay. Then after a period of time, what happens is the senses know to remain without being distracted by the outside world. The senses will have to be trained in this particular way because that's the starting point. What do you mean by bringing the senses under control? By preventing the senses to go after the various objects in the outside world. Now once I am able to break this automatic connection between the senses and the objects, once I am able to take a deliberate effort and then prevent the objects creating sensations immediately the moment they are in contact with them, over a period of time my senses are not going to be a source of distraction. That's the best way by which a yogi is able to develop ekagrata, all the samadhi he is all talking about. The most important distraction is from the outside world. And then how am I distracted? I am distracted by the senses.
I'm distracted by the senses. No, I must train myself. I must train myself so that the outside, all the objects outside will not have the same, what you call, captivating power it appears to have right now.
60. Yatato hyapi kaunteya purushasya vipaschitaha indriyani pramathini haranti prasabham manaha.
Wait, what is my kaunteya? Say something. What is kaunteya?
Arjuna.
Arjuna again, okay. Why is it called, why is he called Kaunteya? Kaunteya, because he is Kunti's son. The mother of, mother of all the Pandavas, her name is Kunti, and then Kunti's son is Kaunteya. Kaunteya, oh Kunti's son, he means surely. Yatataha means attempting. Now I am started attempting. Attempting means I make attempts. I make frequent attempts to, dissociate the object from me. Okay, that's what yoga is about. Yatataha, vipaschitaha, and then seeing perfectly, purushasya, vipaschitaha. Vipaschitaha means he is able to see it clearly. He is able to see clearly. Purushasya of that yogi, manaha api, his mind also, pramathini, the turbulent indriyani, prasabam forcefully haranti pulls away. He says the senses are very powerful, okay. He is merely warning us, it is not easy to do it, because mind also, pramathini, the turbulent indriyani, forcefully pull away. Even though when the yogi is able to attempt this, he wants you that the senses are so powerful that they will be able to drag you away. It requires enormous effort, that's the whole idea. It's not that just easy, okay, I will start preventing the senses from going to the objects. I can't do that. It takes a lot of effort. Okay, now 61.
Tani sarvani samyamya yukta asita matparaha vashehi yasya indriyani tasya prajna pratishthita.
Okay, now he says the next sutra, it is not easy to control the senses. So now he wants to deal with that.
Tani sarvani samyamya yukta asita matparaha vaśehi yasya indriyani tasya prajna pratishthita tasya prajna pratishthita.
His mind will be well established. Whose mind? Yuktaha. Yuktaha means a yogi. Yuktaha means yogi, another term. Yukta means unite. The person whose mind is completely focused. Yuktaha. Tani sarvani samyamya. Tani means all. All means all the indriyas. Tani sarvani, all the indriyas. Samyamya, completely controlling. Samyamya means completely controlling. Tani sarvani samyamya. Matparaha asita. Matparaha means, para means the highest one. Who is the highest one? The Lord is the highest one. Matparaha. Focusing their attention on me. Matparaha asita should remain. Now he is introducing something else. He has been talking about the Atman so far. Now he is talking about the Paramatma. He says that, all right, focus your attention on me. Initially, it is easier. You see, in the Yoga Sutras, we got the first portion of the first chapter where you got to focus attention on the Atman, try to understand your Atman. And in the second chapter, he says, all right, try to focus your attention on Ishvara, and then that will also be helpful. So, matparaha, aiming, keeping your attention on me, asita, you should remain. He, because, yasya indriyani, whosoever, the senses of those persons, vashe, if it is brought under control, tasya prajna pratishtita. His prajna, his mind, his buddhi, prajna pratishtita is well established.
He's saying, I am the Lord, I am the Paramatma.
Yes, I am the Paramatma. That's what he says.
This is the first time he announces it.
Yes, so far he has been talking about Atman, Atman, Atman. Now he says that you focus attention on me. Because why? Because it is very difficult for you to control your senses. Those people who have difficulty control the senses, take refuge in Lord. Focus your attention on the Lord. Otherwise, what happens? I don't know the nature of my own self. There is nothing to hold on to. Now I got the Paramatma to hold on to. If I have no problem, believing in God, the passage is much, much smoother. If I have difficulty believing in God, yes. Everybody recognizes that some people have difficulty believing in God, not merely dogmatic, They say, I don't think I'll be able to. They have difficulty with that, Such people will have to go through yoga step by step, do asana, pranayama, everything. But on the other hand, if you have got no problem believing in God, you got a solid ally in you. You take his help. you take his help. Okay, we'll go to the next one. Dhyayato vishayan pumsaha sangasteshu upajayate sangat sanjayate kamaha kamat krodaha abhijayate. Now he said that, you know, if you really want to save yourself, you must control your senses. You must control your senses. You can't allow the senses to have a sway over you. Vishayan means what? Objects. Object is the senses. Various beautiful, what do you call it? Nice sounds, nice sights, nice contacts, physical contacts, nice tastes, all of them are there. Vishayan, dhyayataha, dhyayataha. Here you use the term dhyayataha to indicate a yogi. Dhyayataha means one who does dhyana, one who does meditation. Dhyayataha, who does meditation? The yogi does meditation. Dhyayataha, pumsaha, that person. Teshu sangha upajayate. Now he wants to tell you the difficulties or the consequences of not controlling the senses. He says it is difficult to control the senses, but you keep your attention on me and then that will be helpful. Having said this, okay, I don't care. I mean, why should I really bother about it? If you don't control the senses, these are the consequences. Starting from the next shloka. Vishayana dhyayataha pumsaha teshu sangam upajayate. Dhyayataha, vishayana dhyayataha pumsaha. The person, pumsaha means a person. Okay, I mean, this should be interpreted differently. Pumsaha means any ordinary person. Pumsaha means any ordinary person. Okay, vishayana dhyayataha. Vishayana means objects, object of the sense. Dhyayataha keeps on thinking about it, you know. He keep on thinking about it. So the whole thing starts from your mind. Even though the objects are distracting, before that, the thoughts are there. The thoughts about the objects are there most of the time, you know, most of the time. Vishayana dhyayataha pumsaha teshu sangam upajayate. Once this, what you call, the thoughts about the objects keep on cropping in your mind, supposing you say you're going for a party in the evening, you know, you start thinking about it from the morning itself. There are anything that they are looking forward to, you know, I'm looking forward to this kind of experience. So I keep on thinking about it from the beginning itself. Vishayana dhyayata teshu sangaha upajayate. Now we get attached to that particular thought, particular desire. Sangat kamaha sanjayate. When you are getting, what you call, attached to that thought, kamaha, desire comes in your mind. Kamaha sanjayate, kamat krodaha upajayate. When kama, desire comes simultaneously, the krodha or anger also comes with you. Because if I am not able to fulfill the desire, many of us are able to fulfill the desire. For many people it is not possible. You know, in India, you know, on the when a new film is released, it's happening. When a new film is released, hundreds and thousands of people want to go to the movie on the first day. They want to go to the movie on the first day. The tickets are sold 200 rupees, 300 rupees. They are prepared to pay 1,000 rupees, get the ticket. So you buy the ticket, 1,000. If you don't have 1,000 rupees, what happens? You go already, finally get for 1,000 rupees, you know, blackmailing your parents, you get that money and then go there, and then when you go there, no, the tickets are not available. You become very angry. So what do? You do a lot of things. You do a lot of things. Sometimes, you know, half a dozen fellows will join together and then throw stones in the theater, break the, you know, lots of things could happen. Crow that. See, they were wanting to go to the movie because they were not able to get that. They are completely, that what you call, the desire to go to the movie has turned into anger. These things happen on a regular basis. Vishayan dhyayaha sangaha uchajayate sanjay kaman krodaha upajayate. Out of the desire only krodha comes. If there is no desire, there won't be any krodha. Supposing I have no desire to go to that particular movie, I will not bother about it. You know, nothing that is happening in the theatre is going to bother me. But for the person, you know, who wants to go to the theatre, see the movie on the first day, in spite of having the money, you know, with all these efforts, he's not able to go, then what happens? He loses his cool. Am I right? He loses his cool. That's called krodha. Krodha.
Krodhat bhavati sammohaha, sammohat smriti vibhramaha, smriti bhramshat buddhinasho, buddhinashat pranashyati.
Then he says, krodhat, from that anger or enmity, sammohaha bhavati. Sammoha means my thinking becomes clouded. That is the situation Arjuna is supposed to be in. Moha means the tamas domination of mind. You can't think properly. You don't think properly. Sammohaha upajayate. Then sammohat smriti vibhramaha. Sammohaha. When mind is confused, smriti vibramaha. Your memory also goes away. You don't remember what happened. See, many times when these things happen, you ask them afterwards, I don't know what happened. I don't know why I did this. Sammohaha upajayate. Krodat sammoha, sammohat smriti vibramaha, smriti bhramshat buddhi nashaha. When the memory goes, then buddhi nashaha. Your ability to think properly, use your buddhi also goes away. Buddhi nashat pranashyati. When your thinking is, you are not able to think properly, okay, such a person pranashyati, he is destroyed, You commit a great mistake and then you got to reap the consequences later on. So he says, Kaman, the desire that arises in your mind, that leads to all these things. So he wants to create some fear in him. 64.
Ragadesha viyuktaihi tu vishyanindriyaischaran atmavashyaihi videyatma prasadam adhigachati. Ragadesha viyuktaihi tu.
Tu means but. Raga dvesha vimuktehi, a person who is freed from raga and dvesha. The same terms used by Patanjali, raga means attachment, dvesha means enmity, both of them are to the same object. Raga dvesha vimuktehi, atma vashyehi, and then who is able to remain within himself, indriyehi vishayane charanne, videyatma prasadam adhigachati, atma vashyehi, keeping the mind under control. Indriyaihi vishayana charanne, when a mind stops going after the objects of the, where does the whole thing start? It starts from the mind. A couple of sutras earlier he said, everything starts from the mind, when all the thoughts about the objects start in the mind. And then, then the indriyas take you to those objects and the rest of the things happen. So, ragadvesha vimuktehi, how am I able to remove the ragadvesha? By focusing your attention on the Lord. Atma vashyaihi, indriyaihi, vishayane charanne, videyatma, prasadam adhigachati. And over a period of time, slowly the mind becomes clear. The mind becomes more and more clear. That is why they use the term, all the thoughts that you take outward are called vana. Vana means what? Fireworks. With so much of force, they go out through the senses. So already ultimately they use the term, when this kind of fireworks in your mind comes to a standstill, that particular state is known as nirvana. The nirvana is used in nirvana. Here also the same term is used, Brahma nirvana. When all these unnecessary thoughts start subsiding, when they all settle down, and that state is known as nirvana state.
Ragadvesha viviktaistu vishayanindriyaischaran atmavashyaihi videyatma. For that is remaining without desires, then completely, in line with the Atman or the Self, then completely stopping the mind going after the various objects of the senses, such a person gets a very clear mind. Okay, when that happens, when the mind becomes very clear, 65.
Prasade sarva dukkanam hanihi asya upajayate prasanna chetaso hyashu buddhihi paryavatishthate. Prasade, when the mind becomes clear, asya, this sarva dukkanam, all the pains that he experiences, hani, destructions, upajayate, happen. Once the mind becomes clear, when the mind is able to remain with the Atman and not go after, see, mind can go outward or remain with the Atman, isn't it? Right now my mind is not remaining with the Atman because I don't know the Atman. I have been identifying with this fellow as the Atman, and this fellow says that, okay, give me that, get me that, get me that. I keep on trying to get that. I see only one side of the whole picture, Once my mind is able to see the Atman, then what will happen? Yes, this is better. Why should I run after the objects? My mind becomes clear. Clear about what? Clear about myself. Once that happens, whatever he's talking about, upajayate. The dukkhanam hani upajayate. All the dukkhas start coming down. Because according to him, the dukkhas are due to the, hankering after the objects of the senses. Prasanna chetasaha. When the mind is, chetas means mind or chitta. Prasanna chetaha, when it becomes very clear. Ashu, buddhim, paryava. Ashu, very quickly, buddhi, the intellect also becomes firm. I need a very clear mind so that my resolution, my thinking, everything will become firm. Once my mind is disturbed, the buddhi has got no time, to settle down and think properly. According to this thinking, the main cause of all these things, allowing the indriyas to dominate over the mind. You are allowing the indriyas to dominate over the mind. How do the indriyas dominate over the mind? To start with, the thoughts are there in the mind. The thoughts are there in the mind because I have experienced all the objects the indriyas had given me. My mind is getting attached to them and my mind keeps on thinking about it. Once my mind starts thinking about it, then I start going after the objects. Now, the indriyas become very powerful. Now, in me, I have the body with me, the indriyas with me, the manas with me, the buddhi with me, then ultimately the atma with me. All of them are there. But now what is happening? Of all these things, the indriyas become powerful. They dominate my conduct. They dominate my conduct. Even my mind follows my indriyas. So he says that there are two things you can do. First of all, you can understand yourself according to the Yoga Sutras. They prove that the body is not the self. They prove that the Purusha, or there is a consciousness in us, which is, we are aware of that consciousness. I may not aware of everything. I may not aware of the outside world. I may not aware of myself. That consciousness is myself, which is non-changing. That he has explained earlier. Okay, but we ignore that. We mean the mind ignores that. Mind ignores us, and then through the senses, it goes after various objects. They give some pleasure, and then additionally, they give some pain also. This cycle keeps going on and on, not only in this janma, it leads to other janma. So everything is outside the Atman. Everything is taking place outside the Atman. Once I am able to see the Atman, and Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says already, if you are not able to do that, I'll just focus our attention on Ishvara. You can focus your attention on Ishvara, and that will help you to, settle down. The mind will settle down. And over a period of time, you will be able to have a control over your own mind. Once you have a control over your own mind, the buddhi will become very strong. You will be able to think more clearly. Only time where the mind can settle down is during the time where you spend with your own self. We don't do that. Right in the morning, the moment you get up, immediately, your wife or husband says, what did we make for breakfast? Or then there are telephone calls, then immediately look at the computer, what are the various things that I got to do? You start going around, and then you come back in the night, and then ultimately you go to sleep. There is absolutely no time for you to. And then even your yoga practice is mostly in a group. You go to a yoga shala or some place and then practice your yoga. It is to be done in solitude. Yoga is supposed to be practiced in solitude. You have to practice it alone. You may learn everything from a teacher, but then ekastapo dviradhyayi, that's what they say. When you want to study dviradhyayi, you need a teacher. You study with a teacher, but then ekastapaha, the tapas should be, tapas here refers to anything that you do to purify yourself. That's called tapas. That is to be done individually. You got to sit down and then do it individually. But unfortunately, again, this the time that you spend with yourself is again not complete. What you do only asanas. You do only asanas. You don't do pranayama. You don't do meditation. That is why they have taken a lot of time to develop a system in which they have included a number of things. They have included not only asana, they have included yamanema, they have included pranayama, pratyahara, then the meditation, then they gave the necessary philosophy, everything is given there. I can't take one element and then say, that'll take care of everything. It can't. It's just simple logic, it will not take care of everything. I got to follow the entire system as it is. Okay? So here he says that if you allow the mind to be distracted by the world, where is the time for the buddhi to sit down, contemplate and think about these things? There is no time for this. And all these things Krishna says at a time when this fellow is absolutely in, a lot of confusion. He says this is the best time to tell him. See, after all he has to convince him to fight. He could have told him everything and that, come on, you fight, we'll meet after everything is over, I will tell you everything. He doesn't say that. Nasti buddhihi ayuktasya na cha ayuktasya bhavanaha na cha abhavayataha shantihi ashantasya kutaha sukham. Ayuktasya, for a non-yogi or the one who has not been able to control the senses, a yogi is one, according to this definition, who is able to control the senses to start with. Ayuktasya, a person who cannot control the senses or who cannot control the mind. Buddhihi, intellect. Buddhihi na asti. Buddhihi means the buddhi or intellect to understand the nature of the self does not exist. Unless I control my senses, I will not have the strength of the buddhi to understand the self. When all the time I am spend all my time answering the whims and fancies of my senses, my buddhi also will be trying to find out ways by which it will be able to fulfill the desires of the senses. They give this example. You see a 100 rupee note or a $100 note, whatever, $100 bill. If I am an honest person, I will take it and then give it to whosoever who is responsible will be able to find out the person whose property it is, and then they will give it to him. If my mind is sattvic, I will do it. If my buddhi is not sattvic, what will I do? I will try to find out ways by which I will be able to take it with me. Okay, the same buddhi. Buddhi is supposed to tell you what is right and wrong, but buddhi sometimes, what does it do? Instead of telling what is right and wrong, it tells you how to achieve something that is not right. That is tamasic mind. That mind is tamasic, or that mind is not sattvic. For the buddhi to be able to, what you call, sit down, analyze, understand the true nature of its own self, you must give the sufficient condition, the right condition for the mind to be able to, buddhi to be able to do that. Otherwise, if you write from the morning to the whole day, if this is what is going on, there is absolutely no time for the buddhi to settle down and start looking at this. These require a lot of effort. It takes a lot of time to convince the mind to be convinced. Why does the mind, why does it not get convinced? Because it is used to a different way of thinking. Krishna says something which I have not heard of so far, isn't it? All my life I have not heard of something like an Atman at all. Those people who have studied these things, it's okay. But you go to a common person and then talk to them, the general public, and talk to them, nobody has heard about it. So because I have not heard about it, I just go about trying to satisfy the desires through my senses. The desires appear in my mind, and then I try to satisfy them through the senses. Yes.
But can also, it's also affected by the gunas.
Yes, it is.
The senses have to be controlled and the buddhi has to be.
Yes, once the senses are controlled, these are become automatic. Once the senses are controlled, it gives an opportunity for the mind to settle down. Once the mind settles down, then the mind will be, what you call, the buddhi will be start looking at these. Now Krishna has already advised him. Now he says, you control your senses and then contemplate on what I have already told you. He has got the necessary theoretical, the knowledge that is required. He is already, if that is not there, it is not possible. Okay, he is going to suggest that, that is also something he has to do in the future. But so long I allow my mind to be distracted by the senses, nothing becomes possible. Absolutely nothing becomes possible. Over a period of time, the same cycle keeps on, more and more thoughts, and then, the buddhi also joins the game. Okay, I will make you happy, you do it this way, you do it this way, rob the bank, or do whatever, Because buddhi is the one that tells you how to do it, Manas cannot do it. The indriyas don't know how to do it. The buddhi comes and says, all right, this is what you want, all right, I will help you. This is how you should do it, so that all of us will be happy. Because buddhi doesn't know the nature of the self, because it also knows, how happiness is being achieved all this time. So this is a vicious circle. A vicious circle, Right. 67. Indriyanam hi charatam yen mano anuvidhiyate tadasya harati prajnam vayurnavam ivambhasi. He, because charatam indriyanam. Indriyanam means the various indriyas, the senses. Charatam, moving out, charatam, indriyanam, yat manaha, the mind, anuvidhiyate, the mind also is dragged along with that, The objects attract the senses want to have contact with the objects, the mind also starts going along with that. Anuvidhiyate is dragged away, that asya prajnam, harati, asya of the individual's prajnam, or awareness, prajnam means, is thinking. Thinking what happens, harati, prajnam harati, it takes away, okay? My mind is completely taken away by the objects of my senses. The senses drag, my mind goes, the whole mind goes after that. I am one-pointed in achieving the object I want to. It is like what? Ambhasi, navam, vayuhu, iva. Ambhasi, in a water, navam. Nava means a boat. A boat in waters disturbed by heavy winds, My mind does not settle down. Okay, 68 shloka. Tasmadyasya mahabaho nigrihitani sarvashah indriyani indriyartebhyah Tasya prajna pratishtita. What is meant by Mahabaho? Whom does it address to?
Arjuna
again. But then, you know, Maha means great, Bahu means arms. You know, he's a warrior. Got nice biceps. Mahabaho. Tasmat, therefore, yasya indriyani, yasya, whose indriyani, indriyas are senses, indriyartyebhyaha, for the sake of the objects, sarvashaha, completely nigrihitane, when they are controlled, I should be able to dissociate the senses with the objects of, deliberately I should be able to do that. Thought arises in your mind, I must tell you, no, this is not good, this is not good, no, I don't want this. I don't want this. I should be able to do that on a continuous basis. Then what happens? The indriyas lose their power to drag you. The whole thing starts in your mind. So, Mahabaho tasmat yasya indriyani indriyartyebhyaha sarvasaha nigrihitani. When the indriyas are completely prevented from going after the objects of their objects, tasya prajna pratishtita, tasya his prajna. Prajna is pratishtita. Can you do it forcefully? No. You need a prop. You need something to hold on to. What is that? According to him, meditate upon me. But on the other hand, if you know the nature of the Atman itself, this can be kept in the back of your mind. No. The Atman, even though I have not directly experienced that particular Atman, I have read in the Bhagavad Gita, in the Yoga Sutra, the Atman does not require any of these things. Now, going after these objects, I am only suffering. Let me stop this. This can be done. This can be done. We'll go to the 69th shloka. Ya nisha sarva bhutanam tasyam jagrati samyami yasyam jagrati bhutani sa nisha pasyato munehe. What does it say? So far as the yogi is concerned, whatever is night for ordinary people, it is day for him. And so far as the yogi is concerned, whatever is day for the ordinary people, it is night for him. There's a difference like day and light. The approach of yogi, what a yogi is able to observe and what ordinary people are able to observe, there seems to be a complete difference. The difference is like day and light. Now, the one interpretation that can be given, which may be acceptable, is that the real self is pure Atman, you know, that is pure consciousness, where other people consider this person as the self. These are the two. Ordinary people consider the body, senses, mind, okay, the whole complex as the Atman, that's called Drishya Atman, whereas the yogi is able to know that this is not the Atman, the Purusha is the Atman. So what happens? In one, there is absolutely no activity, whereas in the other, there is a lot of activity going on. The mind is there, the indriyas are there, a lot of happiness, unhappiness, a lot of things are going on in this particular person. If the yogi is able to see day, when others are seeing it as night, what does it mean? So far as the Atman is concerned, the yogi is able to see that Atman. The yogi is able to see that particular Atman, okay? So he has clarity about it. So it is like day. Whereas for the ordinary people, there is no Atman. There is no Atman separate from this. So it looks like night. In night, what do you see? Nothing. You don't see anything because there is no light. Because the yogi is able to, what do you call, use this yogic light, if you want to call it, to be able to understand this. So what is day for yogi is night for others. What does it mean? Whatever the yogi is able to consider as the self is not the self for other people. Very simple, straightforward. On the other hand, because the yogi is able to see the Atman as everything, he has got absolutely no interest in the outside world. He is able to see the outside world as night. He has got no interest in this. Absolutely no interest in this. Am I making sense?
Yes.
So this is one way this particular shloka can be interpreted. Shloka number 70. Apuryamanam achalapratishtam samudramapapravishanti vayadvat tadvat kamayam pravishanti sarve sashantim apnoti na kama kami. This is an idea that you find even in the Upanishad. They talk about this. So, Oshnute sarvan kama ansaha, the one who is able to understand the Brahman or Atman, whatever, is able to realize that sarvan kaman, you know, the what do you call the kind of peace, the kind of mental state that he is in, is as though all the desires are what you call experienced at the same time. All the desires are fulfilled at the same time. Why do they say this? Because we are all interested in fulfilling of desires. Okay, now all right, you struggle very hard to get a small amount of happiness by running around like this. Whereas a Brahmajnani or a person who is able to understand the true nature of the self, he is able to have a state of mind which is equivalent to enjoying all the desires that you have. The mental state of the yogi is so desirable that it will not be equivalent to you are experiencing all the desires at the same time. So here the same idea is taken up here, and then he says, ఆపూర్యమాణం అచలప్రతిష్టం సముద్రమాప ప్రవిశంతి యద్వత్ తద్వత్ కామాయం ప్రవిశంతి సర్వే సశాంతిం ఆప్నోతి న కామకామీ. ఆపూర్యమాణం ఇస్ ఫుల్లీ ఫిల్డ్, యునో ఇఫ్ యూ సీ ది ఓషన్ ఇట్ ఇస్ ఫుల్, యునో ఇట్స్ ఫుల్, వేర్ ఆస్ ది లేక్స్ ఆర్ నాట్ ఫుల్, దే మే బి ఫుల్ సమ్ టైమ్, దే మే నాట్ బి ఫుల్ సమ్ టైమ్. సో ఫార్ ఎస్ ది సీ ది ఓషన్ ఇస్ కన్సర్న్, ఇట్ ఇస్ ఫుల్ ఆల్ ద టైమ్. ఆపూర్యమాణం అచల ప్రతిష్టం, అండ్ దెన్ వెన్ యూ వట్ యూ కాల్ వెన్ యూ గో లిటిల్ అవే ఫ్రమ్ ది షోర్స్ యూ విల్ ఫైండ్ ది వాటర్స్ ఆర్ వెరీ స్టిల్. అచల ప్రతిష్టం సముద్రం ద ఓషన్ ఆపహ యద్వత్ ప్రవిశంతి. నౌ ద వాటర్స్ ఫ్రమ్ వేరియస్ అదర్ ప్లేసెస్ ఇన్ ద ఫార్మ్ ఆఫ్ రెయిన్ ఇన్ ద ఫార్మ్ ఆఫ్ రివర్స్ బట్ దే ఆర్ ఆల్ ఫ్లోయింగ్ దే ఆర్ నాట్ స్టడీ దే ఆర్ స్మాల్ దే ఆర్ నాట్ ఫుల్ఫిల్డ్ యూనో ఆల్ ఆఫ్ దమ్ కమ్ అండ్ దెన్ రీచ్ ది ఓషన్ ఆల్ ఆఫ్ దమ్ కమ్ అండ్ రీచ్ ఓషన్ యద్వత్ ప్రవిశంతి తద్వత్ సర్వకామాః యం ప్రవిశంతి లైక్ వైజ్ సర్వకామాః ఆల్ ద డిజైర్స్ సర్వకామాః యం ప్రవిశంతి హూమ్ సో ఎవర్ ఇట్ ఎంటర్స్ సహా శాంతి మాప్నోతి. వాట్ ఈస్ హీ ట్రైడ్ టు సే, వాట్ హీ ట్రైస్ టు సే ఇస్ నార్మలీ వాట్ వీ డూ, వీ గో ఆఫ్టర్ ది ఆబ్జెక్ట్స్ ఆఫ్ డిజైర్, వీ గో ఆఫ్టర్ ది ఆబ్జెక్ట్స్ ఆఫ్ డిజైర్. నా ఇన్ దిస్ కేస్ వాట్ హ్యాపన్స్ ద రివర్స్ ప్రాసెస్, all the desires come to you, you know, you without any effort you are able to feel the happiness of having fulfilled those desires. He gives that example of a, what you call in an ocean when all the waters like kamas, the desires, instead of what you call water going out of from a lake or a tank, now waters come to the, likewise all the desires come and reach this particular person. What does it mean? He will be very happy. Such a person will be happy, or we don't have a proper word for that. His mental state is so, what you call, so agreeable, so sukha, tushta, you know, so agreeable, you know. This will be equivalent to, you know, experiencing all the sukhas at the same time. This is again explained in the Taittiriya Upanishad very beautifully. He says that the kind of experience you are able to get when you go to this particular world, you know, is the same as a person who has renounced all the desires. Then you go to the next higher world. Okay, what is the kind of experience that you, kind of happiness that you experience in the higher world? It is 100 times more than the lower world. Okay, 100 times more than the whole. Even then, that is, you know, that happiness is experienced by a person who renounced all the desires because he knows the Brahman. So like that it goes on. And then ultimately he says, you know, it is beyond, you know, it is beyond what you are able to get by other means. సో ఇట్స్ ఎ నైస్ శ్లోక. ఆపూర్యమాణం అచల ప్రతిష్టం సముద్రమాప ప్రవిశంతి యద్వత్ తద్వత్ కామాయం ప్రవిశంతి సర్వే సశాంతిమాప్నోతి న కామకామి. శాంతిమాప్నోతి రీచెస్ హీ గెట్స్ ఎ పీస్, అబ్సల్యూట్ పీస్. వన్స్ యూ గెట్ ఆల్ ది వాట్ ఎవర్ యూ డిజైర్ యూ గెట్ ఇట్ యూ ఎక్స్పీరియన్స్ ఎ మూమెంట్ ఆఫ్ పీస్ అట్ ద ఎండ్ ఆఫ్ దట్ అండ్ ద ఎక్స్పీరియన్స్. నౌ హీ ఈజ్ ఏబుల్ టు ఎక్స్పీరియన్స్ enormous peace. 71. Vihaya kaman yas sarvane pumam sharati nispruhah nirmamo nirahankarah sashantim adhigachati. Yaha whosoever puman, any person, sarvan kaman all desires, vihaya giving up, nispruhah without being touched by the desires, nirahankarah without the ego that I am the one who is doing everything, నిర్మమః దీస్ ఆర్ మై వాట్ యు కాల్ మై పొసెషన్స్ సహ శాంతిం అధిగచ్చతి. ఓకే, ద పర్సన్ హూ ఇస్ ఏబుల్ టు రనౌన్స్ ఆల్ ది డిజైర్స్, ద పర్సన్ హూ ఇస్ ఏబుల్ టు వాట్ యు కాల్ సర్వాన్ కామాన్ డిజైర్స్, దెన్ నిస్పృహ ఈస్ నాట్ బీయింగ్ అఫ్లిక్టెడ్ బై ది డిజైర్స్ ఎనీ లాంగర్. నిరహంకార మీన్స్ అహంకార, అహంకార మీన్స్ ద రాంగ్ ఐడెంటిఫికేషన్ విత్ దిస్ దృశ్య ఆత్మ యాజ్ ద సెల్ఫ్. నిరహంకార without ahankara, nirmamaha, and then the other attack, this is mine, this is my property, this is my country, this is my language, this is my reputation, you know, these are my possessions, you know, this is called nirmamaha, mine, these are mine, nirmamaha. Charati, Okay, nirmamaha, without charati, moves around this world. Such a person who moves around this world, saha shanti madikachyate. Such a person is able to achieve perfect peace. Perfect peace. Just one more shloka, I guess. Yesha brahmi sthitaha partha nainam prapya vimukhyati sthitva asyam antakalepi brahma nirvana mrichyati. Once you develop this, even at the last moment, you will be able to maintain this. Because last moment, you know, the last moment there could be fear of death. But he says that even that fear will not be there. Even that fear will not be there. So he explains this. Partha means what? Arjuna. Yesha, this Brahmi Stitihi, what do you call Brahmi Stitihi, established in the ultimate Brahman. Atman, Brahman, these are terms which are according to Advaita, they are synonymous. Brahmi Stitihi, Yenam Prapya, having achieved that particular Brahmi Stiti, Na Vimukhyati, you will never be confused. Antakale Epi, even at the time of death, Asyam Sthitva, Asyam means in this Brahman, in this Atman, the mind is going to be in this Atman or Brahman, Sthitva remaining, Brahma Nirvana Mrichati, you know. What is by Brahma Nirvana? When in the Brahman, there is no activity, it is just consciousness, there is no activity. Brahma Nirvanam Abhigacchati is able to see death taking place without absolutely any disturbance whatsoever. Because this is one of the concerns all of us have is about death. If the person is able to reach that Brahma Nirvana, he will not be afflicted by, he wants to add one more thing. He will not only be remaining peaceful all through the life, even at the time of death, he will remain peaceful. Okay, with this, the second chapter ends.